What's going on, boys and girls? What's up, world? Austin John Plays here, and today we're going to talk about why Banjo in Smash is such a big deal. At E3 2019, we got the reveal of Banjo-Kazooie coming to Super Smash Bros. Ultimate as paid DLC as part of the Fighter's Pass, and gamers like myself had this to say.
Banjo-Kazooie, we're home.
And I myself even shed a few tears.
Yes! I've been saying it for over a year! It's finally happening! Yes!
And then to see the bear and bird duo completely redesigned, looking much more like their iconic original N64 self using signature moves from their first two games, made every fan feel overwhelmed with joy. But if you did not own a Nintendo 64 when it was the hottest system to have, or if you were too young to play these games, you may be asking, why is Banjo such a big deal? I wanted to talk about that, the history of Banjo-Kazooie, the studio that created them, and the reason that this iconic duo is so near and dear to hearts of gamers like myself. In the mid-90s, Nintendo was pitched a process of advanced computer modeling to produce 3D models and graphics, and these models were rendered onto a SNES cartridge, something that had never been done before, even by Nintendo themselves, and definitely not by a third-party studio. Nintendo was blown away by the company who was able to use this technology and make a game look so much more realistic than what we've seen with the blocky Mario look. Nintendo immediately bought 25% share of this company, which would later grow to 49%, and this company was named Rare. At this point, Rare was now a second-party developer for Nintendo, and their first big game on the Nintendo platform was Donkey Kong Country, which was praised for its highly advanced visuals and art style. Donkey Kong Country would go on to sell 8 million copies worldwide and become the third best Super NES game of all time. The other three games in the top four were all made and published by Nintendo, featuring its world-famous plumber in Super Mario World, Mario All-Stars, and Super Mario Kart. Donkey Kong Country also won Game of the Year by Electronic Gaming Monthly, Game Informer, Electronic Games Magazine, as well as the Video Software Dealers Association Awards. These incredible sales and praise led the way for Rare to make two direct sequels of the game, as well as several handheld spin-offs. These games would be the first appearance of Diddy Kong, as well as several other iconic primates. When it came time for the Nintendo 64 to be released, Rare wanted to make something other than Donkey Kong games. Their studio staff had more than tripled, and Rare was split into several teams working on different projects. Rare's first project for the N64 was GoldenEye 007, based off of the film, a free-roaming first-person shooter that introduces new elements that are currently staples in the genre to date, such as the headshots mechanic, reloading, and stealth. This game too would sell 8 million copies, receive numerous awards, critical praise, and become a staple of the sleepover multiplayer video game fun that 8-year-olds would have worldwide with its 4-person split-screen mode. Rare's next endeavor was Diddy Kong Racing, the first self-published game which released in 1997, a year after Mario Kart 64. This was one of the fastest-selling games at the time and featured a slew of characters that were new and creative, some of whom which would become protagonists in future Rare games, including Conker and Banjo. At the same time, Rare was still working on a large-scale platform game, originally codenamed Dream, Land of the Giants. It was a game featuring a young boy named Edison and pirates. Edison was later replaced by a bipedal bear known as Banjo, and the team wanted, and I quote, a realistic double jump that could be performed anywhere, which led to wings coming out of Banjo's backpack and several other platforming situations which required additional mechanics, and later the idea of a bird living in Banjo's backpack was fleshed out to be Banjo's platonic life partner, Kazooie. The game Dream was in development for such a long time, and when they finally put Banjo in, they realized that the game wasn't really that fun, and it felt dated. They saw Super Mario 64 and felt that that game would be the new standard of the 3D platforming genre, So they decided to take the game that they currently had with Banjo in a new direction. And with a very clear idea on what they wanted to achieve, they were able to make a demo in a very short amount of time. According to Rare, "We wanted the characters to primarily appeal to a younger audience, but at the same time, give them enough humor and attitude not to discourage older players." Banjo was fleshed out to be a wholesome, dim-witted bear, and Kazooie was a cheeky, annoying, squawking bird, and the antagonist was a rhyming witch that kidnapped Banjo's sister, Tui, to suck her beauty away using a machine and become beautiful herself. Mix that with great platforming and array of moves for a bear and bird duo to learn, a literally outstanding soundtrack by Grant Kirkhope, and lots of subtle adult British humor, and it was a golden idea. Banjo-Kazooie was a critical and commercial success, selling more than 1.8 million copies in the United States and more than 405,000 units in Japan at launch. It was reviewed by GamePro to be a more complex, more fluid, and more attractive game than its plumbing predecessor, Super Mario 64. Piers Schneider from IGN felt that Banjo-Kazooie was, and quote, "the best 3D platformer he has ever played, and way more than a worthy successor to Super Mario 64. These two are but a few examples of how everyone feels about the game, scoring 9.5s and the equivalent across the entire board of reviews. Banjo-Kazooie is the all-time 10th best-selling game on the N64 at 3.6 million copies worldwide. I personally say that Banjo-Kazooie is an evolution of Super Mario 64. It has more personality and it takes more risks. Mario 64 is lovable because it's Mario, and it's a tale as old as time of saving a princess in distress, but Banjo creates his own story in his own world that perfects the collect-a-thon platforming genre. This was a game that I loved at the time when I was 10, a game that I loved as a teen when I got more of its adult humor, and a game that I love today for all the reasons I mentioned above. And 2 years later, Rare released Banjo-Tooie, the sequel to Banjo-Kazooie, and it largely adopts the gameplay mechanics of the first game, but it has even more variation of the moves. Kazooie jumps out of the backpack, and each of the bear and bird are playable on their own, where their personality becomes even more fleshed out. The music is as good as ever thanks to Grant Kirkhope, and the game implemented amazing concepts, that the levels that Banjo-Kazooie enters are part of the same world. There are many quests involving going back and forth between the various worlds from different entryways and a railway system. With all this praise, as fantastic as the game was, it only sold about 1.5 million copies, less than half of the original. Just to state how much of a forward-thinking, amazing game this was, at the very beginning they say, "Hey, did you play the first one? Because then you don't need the tutorial, and then you just get all of your moves back, and that's fantastic. Every game should have that forever." This was 2002. During the early 2000s, Rare put out so many good games that I'm not going to cover here because we're focusing more on Banjo-Kazooie, but between the games that I've already mentioned, as well as Donkey Kong 64, Perfect Dark, Jet Force Gemini, and the cult classic mature platformer, Conker's Bad Fur Day, anyone who owned an N64, or still do, has at least three of these games by Rare. But then, we move on to the dark ages for Banjo. With the move to more advanced hardware, production costs for games increased. Nintendo did not provide Rare with more capital, nor did they purchase the company's remaining 51% stake. Rare was surprised that Nintendo did not directly acquire the studio, so they started to look for potential buyers. And September 24th, 2002, Microsoft purchased Rare for $375 million. They became a first-party publisher for Microsoft's Xbox. Characters trademarked by games developed by Rare for Nintendo consoles such as Conker and Banjo were retained by Rare and owned by Xbox. Intellectual property created by Nintendo such as Donkey Kong and Star Fox were retained by Nintendo. This left Diddy Kong Racing, due for release on the GameCube, unreleased, and 30 employees left Rare during this transition. Since Microsoft did not have a handheld console, Rare still made the games for Nintendo's handheld, the Game Boy Advance, of which there were two Banjo games, Grunty's Revenge and Banjo Pilot, which was supposed to be a Diddy Kong pilot, a follow-up to Diddy Kong Racing, but that didn't happen. Neither are praised with being that great, with scores around 6.5. They sold 330,000 and 100,000 copies respectively, and I've never played either of them. This was the story for Rare from then on out. They made game after game that either didn't do well commercially and or critically. They did update the graphics of Conker's Bad Fur Day and release it on the Xbox 360 with multiplayer, but it was just a port. The first we'd see of a bear and bird on a home console in over 8 years was on the Xbox 360 and Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts. It's a game that you control Banjo, but he's fat and needs a car to drive him everywhere. You can customize the car, which is cool, and make it into a plane or a hovercraft, and it's a really dope concept, but it's not Banjo-Kazooie 3. The game got a very wide range of reviews, from the range of 5 out of 10 to 9 out of 10. It's a mixed bag of reviews for a mixed bag of a game. I actually bought my first Xbox 360 just to play Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts. And after my first time playing the game, I got the red ring of death on my Xbox 360 and my disc was stuck inside, so I had to literally pry open the door of my Xbox 360 just to get the disc out, and then I immediately threw my Xbox in the garbage. Summarizing the next 10 years of Rare into the next 15 seconds, they made mediocre games for Xbox and Kinect. They released a compilation of 30 games previously developed by Rare, including an HD version of Banjo-Kazooie and Tooie, which that's the footage you've been seeing in this video, and it got pretty great reviews. Oh, and they made Sea of Thieves. I sure did enjoy playing the same three missions for 40 hours at launch. As far back as 2012, former Rare employees came up with the idea to make a spiritual successor to Banjo-Kazooie. They then later formed a new studio, Platonic Games, and raised money on Kickstarter for their new game. How much did people want a new Banjo game? The company put out a goal of 175 Great British Pounds and met their goal in 40 minutes. Within a few weeks, they raised over $2 million from over 80,000 backers, myself included. This was the birth of Platonic Games and the birth of Yooka-Laylee, a chameleon bat duo with very similar ideas and mechanics to Banjo-Kazooie. It was released on April 11th, 2017, and I enjoyed the game thoroughly, although I feel as though it's more of a successor of Banjo-Kazooie than Banjo-Tooie, where Tooie had much more advanced mechanics and things that you could do and moves, and this just kind of feels like you take the same original idea and think of it differently. I guess that's what a spiritual successor is, but after you play Banjo-Tooie and then you play Yooka-Laylee, it's like, oh, I thought I could do a lot more. Yooka-Laylee received mixed or average reviews on the PC, PS4, and Xbox One. However, when it was released later on the Nintendo Switch, it received generally favorable reviews. Critics generally agreed that the game recaptured the feel of a classic 3D platformer with brand new concepts, but they were divided over whether this made the game successful or simply made its gameplay and game design feel unoriginal and outdated. Less than 6 months later of the release of Yooka-Laylee, Playtonic tweeted that the game hit a milestone of over 1 million players. Not bad for a small studio of employees that left a company for various reasons. It almost sounds like the plot to a movie. Playtonic seems to be doing quite well. At E3 2019, they just announced a brand new side-scrolling game with Yooka-Laylee involved in it. We'll see how that turns out. But since Microsoft's acquisition of Rare and Banjo, fans of the series, such as myself, ultimately felt like we'd never see our beloved quirky duo on a Nintendo home console again. The closest thing we get to Banjo 3 is just the HD remakes that you could play on the Xbox One, which are free games with Game Pass, I believe, so if you have Game Pass, I recommend you check out those games. But to see Banjo and Kazooie returning to the Nintendo Switch, even as just paid DLC for Smash Ultimate, it makes me hopeful. And every other gamer who freaked out at the sight of them, it makes us all hopeful. We got Cloud in Smash 4 and then brought over to Smash Ultimate, and then Final Fantasy VII finally came to a Nintendo home console. If you didn't know, Final Fantasy VII was supposed to come out on the N64, but due to hardware limitations, they went with the PlayStation 1. And then about 20 years later, that same exact game finally came to Nintendo. Many people feel as though seeing a third-party character in Smash solidifies them as being friendly with Nintendo, and games of their series will be coming to Nintendo as a possibility. That's why Banjo coming home is a big deal. And hopefully Microsoft will give the green light for Rare to start Banjo 3E. I'm Austin John, and this is the story on why Banjo coming home is a big deal. If you've enjoyed this style of video, be sure to leave a like down below. If you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe, turn on notifications. Until next time, Austin John out.